To be praised. You know, there are times when I'm looking at the bulletin and the thing says there's supposed to be a song here, and there are times I wish I could sing, Elder. But I'm anxious to get into our message this morning. And I'm just going to ask that you would again just quickly bow with me as we go before the Lord. Father, take now this vessel and use it with power and clarity to share and to reveal your express will to each man, woman, boy, and girl here under the sound of my voice. So that when we leave here today, that we might know that we have tabernacled in the very presence of God Almighty. That we may have seen him high and lifted up. And that we might leave this building today knowing him better and loving him a whole lot more. For this we pray and beg in Jesus' name. Let everybody say amen. Amen. And I think we're good. All right, that was my fault, guys. All right. I'm going to say we got through last month, not that we finished last month in the book of Daniel. Not that we got through, but we moved through. It is difficult to tackle a book like the book of Daniel and to finish it. As we get to chapter 12, the angel comes to Daniel and says to Daniel to close up the book and seal it until the time of the end. We are told that as we get closer to the end of time, that we ought to spend a whole lot more time studying the prophecies of both Daniel and Revelation. Now, there are some of us that were born and raised in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and you may feel that you are Daniel and Revelationed out. That you've heard as much as you can take about images and beast and timelines and et cetera, et cetera. And I'll give you some elbow room on that, because there's a lot of us who know a whole lot about Daniel and Revelation and don't know a thing about Jesus. However, it is still God's express and living word. And it is by spending time in his word, by his design, not ours, that he has designed that we would come to know him better. By spending time. And that book, particularly Revelation, he says that it is a revelation of Jesus Christ. And so I want to continue to motivate, inspire, push you, encourage you, lead you in reading and studying those prophetic books which tell so much about what lies before us. And I just want to make sure that we know that just what you get on Sabbath mornings ain't, I know that's not good English to my teachers, I'm saying it for emphasis, but it ain't enough. That you can't come here on a Sabbath morning and listen to a speaker speak for 30 minutes to an hour and then feel like you've got everything you need to face the enemy of your soul. You got to spend some time on your own in the mornings and in the evenings. Not just on Sabbath, but on Sunday and Monday, and Tuesday and Wednesday, Thursday and Friday. And if God could give us an extra day, we would need that one too. And so I just want to say to you, I want to encourage you, continue to dig deep into the Word of God. This month, we are shifting our theme to something that at one point seemed like it would be somewhat of a challenge to preach from. And so we're going to do two things today, three things that we're talking about. One, we're going to continue talking about evangelism, what we talked about on last week, and one of the tools that we will need to be successful in evangelism. Number two, we're going to talk about that particular tool, and it is prayer. And number three, we're going to see if we can learn some lessons from rivers. This entire month, our theme is going to be lessons from what, everybody? Lessons from rivers. We're going to see what rivers today can teach us about those two things, evangelism and prayer. I made up in my mind this morning that this lesson didn't need to be long. Simple points, simple lesson. But it might be a little longer than I expected because I'm going to need you to help me with it today. Is that all right? Lessons from rivers. I want to start today. I'm not going to be talking about any particular river specifically, but just rivers in general. And to start off, do I have anybody in the audience today, in the congregation today, that is at least, I'm going to find something, 6'6" or taller? Anybody? All right. Can I borrow you for the next 15 minutes? Come on down. He said, man, why did I have to do that? Charles, you're 6 foot. I'm seeing this other 6 foot six. Come on down. You come on, Charles. You can be 6 foot today. 6 foot six. Charles, you ain't no 6 foot six, boy. Come on down, my young man. Come on down. Are y'all there? Nah, that looks like that's some 6 foot six. All right. I'm going to have you guys come on up. Come on all the way up here. They're going to help us illustrate a little bit today how some rivers work. I got to do this. I got it. My goodness. How tall are you actually? 6'6". All right, 6'6". I picked a good number. All right, 6 foot. I'm going to have you guys come and stand right here on the top here. All right. So generally, rivers at their beginning, they generally begin on the top of a mountain. Not always, but generally speaking, if you're looking at the source of a river, they usually begin on the top of a, this is our mountain. This is our mountain right here. Now, the mountain births a river when God sends some precipitation. And the precipitation usually comes in one of two forms. It is either rain or snow. All right? I got some rain and some snow over here. All right. Now, most of you who know your geology and whatever else this is called, you know that this whole thing is a cycle. And I'm not going through the whole cycle. But when the cloud... This is a what? When the cloud is sent by who? By God. And it comes and it rests over the... Now I'm going to need you guys to hold this up over your heads. All right. Man, that's a tall mountain. That when the cloud comes and it rests over the mountain, then there's something that happens. Is Sister Miller here? She's going to get on me. And then the snow or the rain begins to fall. And when the snow and the rain begins to fall on top of the mountain, there's something else that happens. I need one more volunteer. I need, if you are about 3 foot, 3 foot five. Come on, is that Dijon? Come on, Dijon. If you are between 3 foot five and 4 foot five, I need you to raise your hand. Where are you? Dijon, come on. Come on, little lady right there. Yep, I see your hand up. Come on down. Come on, Dijon. Come on, right here, Dijon. Just hop up right there. All right? All right, I've got two. I need four more. I see one right there on the aisle. Come on down, young man. I see this little lady right here. Come on down. Yep, in the white sweater there. Did I see a hand in here? Yes. All right, come on, young man, right there. I've got one, two, three, four, five. I need one more. Let's make some space. All right, all right. You got it? Oh, shit, trip. All right now. All right. Okay. One, two, three, four. I need one more. One more. One more. Okay. Come on, little lady. Come on down. All right. Yeah. Let's go. You take you the steps. All right. Okay. So come on back here with me, guys. We're going to stand right here at the base of the mountain. Right here at the base of the mountain. Okay, so now watch what happens. When the rain begins to fall, the water from the mountain starts making some little puddles. Here's a puddle right here. Grab this puddle. You're a puddle. Tell everybody your name.
Mishael.
Everybody say, good morning, puddle. All right, here's a puddle right here. And then there's some more rain, and we come and find another puddle right here. Tell everybody your name. All right, say good morning, puddle number two. All right, we're going to put this puddle over here, right here. Come stand right back on top of here. And then there, the rain begins to continue coming down the mountain. And there's another puddle, and this puddle's name is?
Kiki.
All right, come stand right here, Kiki. All right, and then the clouds still produce more rain. You guys' arms are going to get tired in a minute. And there's another puddle, and this puddle's name is?
Tyler,
and Tyler's going to come stand right here, and then there's another puddle, and the puddle comes, and puddle's name is?
Zaria.
Who?
Zaria.
And then there's another puddle that comes, and this puddle's name is?
Dijon.
All right. So, the water comes down on the mountain, and the mountain begins to form these independent, separate little puddles. And these puddles are sitting in their nice little puddle world having a wonderful time. Have a wonderful time. All right, they're having a wonderful time. And while they're in those little puddles, eventually, so you remember, this puddle came what? First. And when this puddle gets enough other water, this puddle begins to feel the gravitational pull down the mountain. And so the puddle begins moving down the mountain because he's got more water. And what happens when more water gets on this? Your mama's going to get me. Gets on this puddle. She also begins to feel the gravitational pull and begins now sliding down the mountain. I'm going to come and have you stand right over here. And then something else happens here. When she gets more water, she ends up moving down the mountain. And then this one ends up getting water and ends up going down the mountain. And this one gets some and ends up getting down the mountain. As the water in these puddles begin to overflow, the context in which they were originally settled on the top of the mountain. But these are still now, they're no longer puddles. They have become streams. And these streams, they are now moving away. You guys can put your hands down now. I know it's going to get tired. But as they're moving away from the mountain, they are moving faster. They're moving stronger. Because the further they get down the mountain, you know what else is happening? Watch this. This, which was once a puddle, is now a stream. And he's flowing this way down the mountain, and he's flowing this way down the mountain, and he's flowing this way down the mountain. You know what this stream is doing? This stream is doing the same thing. She's flowing this way down the mountain, and this way down the mountain, and this way down the mountain, and then all of a sudden, bam! This stream meets this stream, and they become a larger stream. Wait a minute. And this stream is flowing down the mountain and flowing down the mountain and flowing down the mountain. And she gets to a point, and this one is flowing down the mountain, going his own separate way, doing his own individual thing. And all of a sudden, by no design of its own, this stream makes no decision to link up with this other stream, but somehow it gets there. Same thing happens here. As these are flowing down the mountain, they're flowing down. At some point along the way, these two streams hook up. You guys are hooked up. There you go, hooked up. You guys are hooked up. All right. Yeah, I didn't mean to do that like that, but. So these streams, you guys are flowing. Give me some flow. Give me some flow, guys. You're flowing. Give me. There you go, you're flowing. All right, there you go, you're flowing. Streams are flowing down the mountain, and eventually these streams run into some obstacles. You know what those obstacles are? The biggest obstacle that these streams face are often the mountain itself. The mountain that they started on becomes the obstacle that gets in their way from getting down to the base of the mountain. But there's a funny thing about these streams. The more obstacles that get in their way, and the more frequently they find other streams to hook up with, the more often the mountain tends to get out of the way. There is something in the power of water flowing down a mountain that is a natural force unlike any other. There is no more, listen to me, there is no more powerful force in terms of its long-term impact and effect on a mountain than a stream flowing down. Oh, y'all didn't get that spiritual application yet. Let me read you a text. You guys good? You good? All right. Isaiah. Go with me to the book of Isaiah. Chapter 43. Isaiah chapter 43. And I want to begin in verse 18. Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 18. Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 18. And the Bible says this: don't remember the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a what, everybody? A new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness, and I will make rivers in the desert. The way that God makes rivers in the desert is it usually starts on top of a mountain. And as the streams begin to flow down the mountain, look what he says rivers are, or they become, in Isaiah chapter 32. Isaiah chapter 32 and verse 1. Isaiah chapter 32, reading verses 1 and 2. And the Bible says this: behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes shall rule in judgment. A man, a what, everybody? A man shall be as a hiding place from the wind, and a cover from the tempest, as rivers of water in a dry place. Oh, did you get that? God is saying that there is coming a time where I will make not a body of water, but a man. A person like you and me, that a person shall be what? Let's look at it again. Shall be like a hiding place from the wind. And a person shall be like a cover from the tempest, and a person shall be like a river of water in a dry place. When is the last time that somebody came to you and said, you are my rivers of water in my dry place? Now, I know, fellas, on a romantic night, you know, Valentine's, just past, you might have said something like that. You are, baby, you are my cover in the tempest. You are my river in my, the river in my desert. But God God is saying, I will have a people who will be like this to somebody else. And so when we're seeing how this river is formed, it comes as God is forming people to become this river. Understand this, that often in that process, there are some things that begin standing in the way of that process. But watch what happens when the river, who started out by God sending the cloud and God sending the rain, as those little drops of water begin coming. Ooh. As those little independent puddles begin flowing down, and as God begins to bring those puddles together, they become streams that now have some power to begin moving some obstacles out of the way. Ah, they didn't get it. 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 All right, let's see if we can do this. All right, so now, Brother Gent, can I use you for just a moment? I want you to just come and stand right here, right in front of me, right here. Will, if I can get you to come and stand right here, right there. All right, now watch what happens. Come on, God. A little further out. Just stand right in the middle, right in the middle, right in the middle. So here's this small stream. As it comes down the mountain, we're going to jump down here, guys, or step down. Here, I'm going to help you down. We go one, two, and three. All right. Got it? You can do it. You're a big boy. All right. As they come down the mountain, they come and they find this big old obstacle. All up in their way. The stream is trying. Hook up. You still hooked up. Go ahead. The stream is still here, and they are trying to push through the obstacle to get down to where the bed of the river is going to be. All right. I need you guys to go ahead and move the obstacle out of the way. No, no. Go ahead and move. Yeah. No. Really? 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 I was telling them to move, not him to move. You are an immovable obstacle. Come on, obstacle. I'm messing up my illustration. All right. Go ahead. Now you're trying to move him a little bit, but watch what happens. So while these little streams, they're not a river yet, but they're on their way to become the river. Watch what happens when God now directs another stream. Come on, little stream. Come on, we're coming here. He directs their flow. They're flowing. They forgot to flow. I forgot to tell them to flow. They're flowing. Y'all still hooked up. Down and down. Now watch what happens when, you guys are hooked up here still, when this stream ends up connecting with this stream. And now this is a larger stream, and now they're all trying to get this obstacle out of the way. Go ahead, get the obstacle out. Okay, stay right there, stay right there, right there. Just stop, stop right there. Listen, when you have obstacles, when the people of God have obstacles in our way, those obstacles are better moved out of the way when the people of God, like streams, are able to link up together and pray to, hey, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. Well, I'm not going to use you because this one works. Go ahead. Thank you. When the people of God, if we were just individually praying, God could still move the mountain. But watch what happens. You see what happens when the people of God come together, pray together, work together to move the obstacle out of the way. And remember, watch this. Come on, we're going to take this other stream. Take this other stream. Come on, stream. Now, we just got a bigger stream. We don't have a river yet. Come on. We hooked up. Come on, stream. You guys were puddles, but now you're a stream. All right, come on. And we're getting down. Got it. Whee, okay. Now this stream is going to finally hook up with this other stream. Hook up right here. Yep, here we go. And now they're going to hook up with here. And now the obstacle or the mountain. What's happening? What's going to happen to the obstacle now? You got to get him down the way. Wait a minute. Will, I'm going to come use you again. So here's something else, and this is just another point. This was a big, large, sharp, rough rock that was an obstacle in the way of the stream. Here was another big, sharp obstacle that was in the way. But when God's stream, when the streams now coalesce and they become no longer a stream, they begin pushing those big, sharp obstacles down the way. Push them. Come on. Push them. Come on. Push them. Okay, stop. Now, watch what happens. Can I borrow the two of you right quick? Come on. As this process takes place, I want you to stand right here by these pews, right there, all right? Stand just right on the corner there. Go all the way up against the pew. All right. As they keep on pushing this, watch what happens. Come on. They're pushing. They're in the river. These are big, jagged, sharp rocks. Watch what happens as they become the river. They get out the way. Come on. Wait. Right here. You're going to take their place. Come on, right here in the middle. Yep. Boom. There. Did y'all see that? Y'all didn't see that, did you? What happened? Those big, sharp, mean, hard, ugly, rocks. In the process, God takes those obstacles that were in the way of the river, and he begins to smooth those things out. He begins to get rid of the sharp edges. He begins to get rid of the things that made it so difficult, so that now, in the end, even those things that pose themselves as big problems that you couldn't push through, by the time, come on, river, keep flowing, going all the way back. By the time the river flows to its ultimate end, God has used the force of the river to even take and make, and sometimes the river takes some interesting turns along the way. But as long as it keeps on flowing, God will take those challenges and those problems as the people of God continue to keep on staying together and praying together and working together. Then God can take those problems, those obstacles, those mountains, and move them out of your way. And in the process, those problems, those things that you thought you just couldn't deal with, they become things that stand as testimonies of the power of God to take something that was rough and uncut and turn it into something beautiful. Thank you. You guys may take your seats. Thank you. You can take your seats. Yes. Come on and play for me. Behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes shall rule in judgment. And a man shall be as a hiding place from the wind, and a cover from the tempest, and rivers of water in a dry place, as the shadow of a great rock in a weary land. As we are preparing our hearts and our minds, ourselves to engage in this evangelism event coming up in next month. There are individuals whose names, circumstances, and situations God is already and is about to place on your heart. I'm going to ask the ushers if they would get themselves in place. They have something that they're getting ready to hand you in just a moment. But as God lays these faces and these names on your heart, this is going to be your first order of business. Not to pick up the phone, leave a voicemail, or shoot a text. Your first tactical move, take that name, fall down on your knees before Almighty God, and say, God, I'm taking my husband and I'm presenting him before your throne. I'm taking my son. I've tried some things before with my daughter. I've tried some stuff. I've tried to force this or to tell them this, and nothing seems. But now, God, I'm simply coming first directly before your throne, saying, God, don't fix them. Fix me. Because, God, if you can fix me, then you can use me. And if God, if you can then use me, then maybe, just maybe, I can become a puddle that you can turn into a stream that can be part of the river. But God, I need you to fix me first. And then when you've taken that prayer before God, you can now look at that name of that son, that daughter, that husband, that wife, that mother, that father, that sister, that brother, that cousin, that auntie, that uncle, that grandparent, that granddaughter, grandson, and say, God, I'm pouring my heart out to you, asking that you would give me wisdom, give me opportunity, give me tact to be something as soft, as gentle, as a puddle of water, but that you can use to turn into a mighty river. How does he turn you into that river? He links you up with other people who are praying, just like you're praying. I want to pause right now. If there's somebody here who knows that there is a burden that God has placed on your heart for some loved one, some friend, some family member, some neighbor, if you know that there's a name that God has just placed on your heart, would you raise your hand with me right now? And I'm going to ask the ushers, as you see those hands raised, they're going to come and they're going to put a card in your hand. And when you get that card, I'm going to ask that you would take that card and that you would write down your name. And in the second spot, you're going to write down the name of that individual. If you have any information for them, write that down. But just the name, if that's fine. And in just a moment, we're going to come and we're going to present those names before God. Keep your hands high. They're coming. They're coming. Some of you have more than one name. We're asking that you come up, every member come up with seven names that we're going to be praying for going into this series. And so if you've got more than one name, as these cards are being passed out, turn it over and just number on the back. You've got one on the front, but on the back, number 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And just write those names in. And listen, here's the strategy again. First thing that you do is you declare yourself a puddle in the hands of Almighty God. And you say, God, I'm just a puddle. And I'm praying that you would take the puddle that I am. You know, a puddle comes, and a puddle isn't all that pretty. A puddle just sits there, and sometimes it becomes stagnant and it gets all muddy and nasty looking, and it attracts all kind of stuff. But it starts, every river starts. First order of business is saying, God, I'm just a puddle, but I need you to transform me into a stream. As you're writing, here's the next step. You've said, God, I want to become a stream that can flow into a mighty river. And so when you've got a name on your card, I want you to stand up from where you are and find somebody else who's standing. And I want you to go and link up with them and come and bring that name, those names down. And we're going to place them in our prayer bucket today. Don't leave your seat unless you come with somebody else. Because you're looking for God saying, I've got these names, but I need to hook up. I need to hook up with another puddle so that I can become a stream. Why? Because there's something powerful about not just praying by yourself, but when the people of God are praying together. When you've got those down, stand up. Look for another puddle. Somebody saying, I'm willing to be a puddle. I just need somebody else to hook up with. Bring that person. Let the Spirit of God move you as you're coming down this mountain, coming down to become. And I want you to stay here. Once you get down, once you put your names in, just stay down here. Come on, come on, come on. These are people who you are praying for and who God has placed a burden on your heart that you might be able to do something, win somebody. Look at that, look at that. We've got a stream coming down the middle of the aisle. God is working and he's moving. He's got to have somebody else just want to be a puddle. Stand up. You've got a name on your card. God wants to use you. I don't. God wants to use you. If you know you've got a name and you just don't have a pen or paper, stand up anyhow and come down. We'll let you get to write that down a little later. We said earlier in our service last week and today that if we're going to reap some souls, we've got to be willing to sow. Got to be able to weep over them. Is somebody's name on this card that you're weeping over now? Some burden, some individual that just you know is far from God. And your soul is already crying out day and night on their behalf. Might be a best friend. Somebody who used to come and worship with you every week here at Daughter of Zion, and you know that the devil is pulling them and he's placing snares and temptations in their path that they are not overcoming, and you're crying out and praying on their behalf, interceding on their behalf. Write that name down. Find somebody else, find another puddle and become part of this stream that God is wanting to turn Daughter of Zion into this mighty river. It's going to flow on his behalf. I'm going to ask Elder Albury if you would come. Today, family of God, what we are going to do today is we are going to take these names that you have placed on these cards, and not just as individual puddles or as individual streams, but as this united river together. We're going to present these names before God, asking that God would take the obstacles that he has placed in our way. Asking that God would take the obstacles that he has placed in their way. And that he would, by this river, move them out of the way. Got those that are still coming. It's not too late. If you You've got to come. Hey, there's going to be some drops that don't join the stream at the same time. They just end up coming and finding their way there. If that's you, just come on down. Just come on down and bring that thing. God knows the desire, the intent of your heart. It's called the Church of the Living God to be a group of people who are willing to recover and restore those who have gone far away from Him. Elder.
Father God, we are grateful for this day, for all that we've heard, puddles. Father, we are praying that you would just take our lives, take us as we are, puddles, and that you would allow us to become streams that find their way to the river. For we know that when we shall do this, and we become what you have called us to be, because you prayed that we become one. And so when little puddles find their way, and they link up with streams, they find their way to one river. And so, Father, we are praying that the Holy Spirit that is here, that even as we are praying, would touch our minds and our hearts and just have us to understand the power that your children hold when they come together.
Yes.
And so for this oneness that you desired for us to become, we are praying that we will become that.
Yes.
But we're only able to do that if we submit ourselves humbly to thee. And so this day, Father, we have come as an example. We have come illustrating publicly that we recognize that we are in need of oneness, only the oneness that you could bring. And so we're praying, Father God, that you would just allow us to empty ourselves so that your Holy Spirit could fill us up to the dregs and we could become what you have called us to be, Christians, children of God. And so as we're praying, Father, we have placed names in a box. There are people that have written names on a piece of paper and their hearts are crying out for mercy for those that they have written on the card. Maybe a child, maybe a loved one, maybe a husband or a wife. Whoever it is, we are praying, Father, that you would remember these names that have been written and placed. You know what that loved one who placed it here desires of that one that is written. And so we are praying, Father, that you come and do only what you can do. They have prayed for them. They have visited them. They have encouraged them. But somehow they are still in need of a Savior. And we're all in need of a Savior. And so, Father, we are praying that you continue to work out a miracle. This is our earnest plea. This is our honest prayer. That you would move mightily, and that you would bless abundantly. For we know that when we shall have become what you've called us to be, the one, the puddles, the stream that finds its way, that we will carve out of this place here in Del Rey a safe place where children can come, where your children will come and be able to drink from the water that you give. Water that will sustain them, water that will allow them to be able to survive in this cruel world. But more importantly, water that will allow them to be filled with the Holy Spirit that we're speaking about, that would allow them to be standing when you shall come, not wanting, but those who will find themselves ready to go back with you. And so we pray that you would do something special for the names that are in the box, that you would do something special for all of those that are standing here, that you would move mightily in our lives. We're praying, Father, that you would allow us to become what you've called us to be, lighthouses in a dark, cruel world. And so, Father, we're asking now that you would continue to bless us. And but above all things, Father, that you would save us all into your kingdom when you come, for we are praying earnestly, Father, that you would do this for us. Bless us now and keep us now, we pray, in the wonderful, magnificent name of our Father, of our Son, and of our Holy Spirit. We're praying, Jesus, that you would save us. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So before you return to your seats, I want you to take a look around the people that are standing in this circle around you this afternoon. And I want you to look somebody in the eye and know that you are not praying for these names alone, but that you are praying for the person standing next to you by your side who's put some names in this box. You are praying for those names along their side. That you are part of the stream, you are part of the river that God wants to take and use to change this city, to change this church, to change this place. That we are inextricably linked through the avenue of prayer in building up the kingdom of God. Squeeze that person's hand on your left, squeeze it on your right, commit, dedicate, consecrate yourself to spending intentional time daily in prayer. And every week from here on out, this meeting, we're going to be coming and praying together over these names every worship service that we have, in Sabbath school, in divine worship, in AY, in prayer meeting, because we are committing to be the river that God needs to make a difference in these stones. God bless you. You may return to your seats.
Ushers,
ushers are shortly going to come and usher us out, but we just want to remind those of you that are part of the choir, the mass choir. I heard it was a 100 voice mass choir, that we're asking that you would come and meet right away over in the Joseph Taylor Jr. Youth Chapel to my right and to your left.